When the sun beats down upon the something, something, yeah. Hey guys, it's Phil from smilinggardener.com. If you haven't picked up my free online organic gardening course, you can do that right on the homepage of smilinggardener.com. Today I'm talking about soil inoculants. Using a soil inoculant might seem kind of strange, so I want to start with why you might want to do it. Now, I talk about my two favorites are compost tea and effective microorganisms. I talk about them elsewhere, and they're good soil inoculants, but I primarily think of them as plant inoculants, like a foliar feed that you spray onto your plants. Today I want to talk about soil inoculants. The reason your soil may be lacking in biological diversity is just some of the things we've done over the years to it. It could be tilling or past chemical fertilizer use or pesticide use or general landscaping practices, or it could be just the generally toxic environment we live in with air pollution and water pollution and some of these things that make their way into our soil. Today I'm going to introduce you to two of my favorite soil microbial inoculants. And the first one is mycorrhizal fungi. And I remember when I was in the Amazon jungle making some videos for you, I was talking briefly about the fungi and how when we're standing in a jungle, all of the trees, or most of the trees, are going to be connected by this network of fungi underground. It's the same thing in our vegetable garden. And what these guys do is they effectively extend the root system of our plants so that they're bringing up nutrients and water far from in the soil up to the plants. And they're protecting the plants from plant predators, and then the plants are giving them carbohydrates and other food in return. So it's this bartering system and this real cooperation that goes on. And not only that, but when all the plants are connected through the same fungal network, plants share nutrients and other products and even information. What I could do to get this fungi is go into a forest and dig up a little soil and then put that soil wherever I want the fungi to be, and that can work okay, but what I prefer to do is to buy an inoculant online. You can even get them on Amazon.com or other places online or in some garden centers. And that way I know exactly what I'm getting. I know I'm getting the right fungi for my needs. And so I'm going to show you what this fungi looks like. It's kind of windy out, so I hope it doesn't all blow away. There it is. This one is really micronized into a powder form, and it'll be on some kind of a carrier like humates or rock dust or something like that. And then this is nice because I can really get it down right around the seed or the plant roots, because you don't want to apply this to the leaves. There's no benefit of that. This relationship occurs at the root level. So that's why the best time to apply it is when you're seeding or when you're planting or when you're growing, you know, even in the nursery. If the nursery applied it, that would be great too. So what I'm going to do, I'll show you. Well, here's a tomato plant. And all I need to do is just take a tiny bit of this fungi. Like, this is plenty. All I need really is maybe half a teaspoon or less for this, and just put it on the roots. I don't have to get all the roots. Even if I just do one side, that's probably fine. And that way that relationship can happen now. Next, I'm on to legume inoculants. So legumes are peas and beans and clover and vetch. And these are really important plants in the garden because they partner up. We call them nitrogen fixing plants, but really what they do is they partner up with nitrogen fixing bacteria. So they help these bacteria create these little homes on their roots. And then the bacteria can go to taking nitrogen out of the air and turning it into a form that plants can use. And that process is the basis for all other life on Earth, really, because it's these bacteria that get the nitrogen that allow us to, and animals and plants to build proteins, amino acids, enzymes, things like that. So really important process. If your legumes can't find the perfect bacteria in the soil to work with, they'll try to work with other bacteria, and if they can find some kind of nitrogen bacteria, they can make it work okay, but it's not going to be optimal. Now, you may just be thinking, well, maybe my beans and peas won't be that great. It's just one crop. It's not that big a deal. But to me, it's a big deal because of the importance of legumes in improving the soil in our garden. It's especially a big deal because in every fall, I like to seed a cover crop that includes legumes, and so I really want them to have their perfect nitrogen-fixing bacteria partners at that point. And so here I have some black beans, as you can see, and then some pole beans that are more beige. And what I can do with this inoculant, you can buy an inoculant, again, in a garden center or online. Especially online, it's easy to find. You can get it in liquid or more of a dry form. I have the dry form here, and there it is. And I just rub it onto all of my seeds at the same time. That's the fastest way to do it. If I were applying a mycorrhizal inoculant to these seeds, I'd do the same thing. Just sprinkle it right on there, and now I have that inoculant on there, and I can plant these. So those are my favorite two soil inoculants, mycorrhizal fungi and a legume inoculant. There are others that are becoming more popular, like a trichoderma fungi, and there are other nitrogen fixing bacteria that live freely in the soil with not on plant roots. And they're interesting, but these are still the tried and true ones. So these are the ones I always recommend starting with. If you have any questions about soil inoculants, ask them down below and I'll answer them. If you haven't signed up for my free online organic gardening course, you can do that down below. And if you haven't joined me and my sister over on Facebook, you can do that at facebook.com/holycowlifeisoawesome and I just love gardening so much.net.